Thank you both for coming in. Columbian is happy to welcome candidates for Lieutenant Governor. We have Marty McClendon and Cyrus Habib. I'm Greg Jane, the editorial page editor, and I believe you met the board members. And Lauren Date, reporter, will be sitting in on this meeting. Won't be asking questions in this forum, but might want to speak with you later.
Okay.
And just so you know, we are videotaping this meeting. We post all of our meetings in their entirety and edited on our website for the benefit of our readers. So with that out of the way, we will start with introductions. Please take 1 to 2 minutes to introduce yourself and explain why you are running for this position. We'll start with Marty.
Okay. I'm Marty McClendon. I'm a Eastern Washington raised guy, Quincy, Wenatchee, and Grand Coulee Dam, Eagle Scout, went to UW for pre-med, spent 13 years in healthcare, 17 years in real estate. Last 2.5 doing a radio show in Seattle as well as doing real estate, and raised my family in Gig Harbor. I've got 3 kids, 19, 14, and 13, Logan, Faith, and Grace. I'm running for this office because I think I bring the right perspective, having grown up in Eastern Washington, been around Seattle, and then, of course, running for Congress in 2014, that I have a better idea of what's going on in around the state. I think I have the right passion for it, but I realize the problem really is the core issues. How do we restore trust in our government so people actually have a voice and they can trust them again? And I think I bring in the right principles as well, saying, you know, we have to put first things first. You know, we know that when we restore families, we restore neighborhoods in the state. So I'm Marty McClendon, Lieutenant Governor candidate. Yeah.
Great. Thank you. Cyrus?
Well, thank you so much. It's really good to be here in Vancouver. Thank you guys for taking the time to do this and for recording it and sharing that. My name is Cyrus Habib. I serve in the Washington State Senate. I represent the 48th Legislative District, which is East King County in the State Senate. Previously represented that district in the House of Representatives. We're going to get into policy, so I guess I'll just tell you a bit about myself, my background. My parents were immigrants to this country. They came here in search of educational and economic opportunities. My dad's a retired Boeing engineer. My mom's a lawyer who now is a Superior Court judge. But shortly after I was born here, I was diagnosed with a rare childhood eye cancer that took my eyesight in my left eye as a newborn, and then came back in my right eye and took my eyesight completely at age 8. And I often joke that happened in 89, so all 8 years that I could see did take place in the 1980s. All my visual memories are from the 1980s, and so everyone still looks like Cyndi Lauper and Boy George. Very odd set of years to have had eyesight. But, you know, I'm so glad to be in Vancouver, in part because as I tell the story of how I was able to go, as I like to say, from Braille to Yale, onto the state legislature, and now to become a candidate for lieutenant governor, Vancouver played a big part of that, because I would come down here pretty much every year as a teenager and get trained at the state school for the blind and learn Braille there, learn how to use software that reads what's on the computer screen so that I can read the Columbian and keep up to date on what's going on here in Clark County, learn how to use a cane. And I even remember coming down here for track and field races and competitions and meets for blind kids and kids who are blind with other disabilities. So I just have this, going back to my childhood, a real love and passion for this place, which is so dedicated to supporting people with special needs and giving them dignity now for over a century that you've been doing that. We'll have a chance to talk more about the Office of Lieutenant Governor, but my experiences as a 3-time cancer-surviving blind Iranian-American from a mixed-religion immigrant family have really informed my passion for public service and why I'm doing this.
Great, thank you. And again, thanks to both of you for joining us. So let's talk about the position of Lieutenant Governor. Primarily, it's presiding over the Senate and when it's in session, and it's filling in for the governor when the governor is out of the state or unavailable. Given that, what do you think are the most important qualifications? What should voters look for in this job? And we'll start with Cyrus.
Yeah, so I think with respect to presiding over the state Senate, I think the most important aspect or qualification there is to be familiar with Senate rules, to be familiar with the relevant constitutional provisions and statutes that govern the conduct of the state legislature, to understand the orders of business. You know, everything is done in a structured way in the state Senate and in the House as well. And when it comes to having a fair and civil discourse in the state Senate, the best insurance to make sure that that happens is following those rules, because they're there for a reason. They're there to ensure fairness in the process. So that's absolutely critical. When it comes to being to serving as the acting governor, I think it is mightily important that you be able to, whether you're in the same party or not, in this state where we run independently, it is important to have a relationship with the governor and to understand state agencies and the way the state works, at least well enough so that if you're dealing with a wildfire emergency, or if you're dealing with some type of a executive department crisis, the governor doesn't have to fly back from the Paris Air Show to deal with it. You need to have that basic understanding of how the executive branch and its functions work.
Marty, which should voters look for?
This is one of those unique positions. Not only do you preside over the Senate, bringing both sides together, but you actually chair the Rules Committee. You do some things like sit on the Finance Committee. There are things executively and legislatively that you work together. I think the voters should look for someone who comes in with a clean slate, someone who has executive experience, who ran a business before, who ran 9 different companies, 150 different agents, with different viewpoints, and bring them together with a statewide view, which is something I bring to it. I have that private sector business background, but I also bring that fact that, you know, I have this world big view. What's good for the state of Washington? What are we here for? What's the agenda here? So following the rules as well, working with both sides, but really with the intent to do what we're supposed to do in the time we're supposed to do it in for the right reasons and that benefits the whole state. And oftentimes I've heard it said, you know, under the dome, there's it's very focused on the now. And a very good friend of mine said that, you know, our founding fathers looked back and had the wisdom of the ages, right? And all too often we get the arrogance of the present. We're just so focused on this. I think we need to have that bigger look. What are we supposed to do? When are we supposed to get there? And kind of cast that vision as lieutenant governor as well.
But that being said, without any experience in the legislature, do you think you could handle presiding over the Senate?
Absolutely. Any business or any structure organization has some sort of leadership thing. I've been there before. Part of everything I've done, whether it be in real estate or in healthcare or pastoring a church or in radio, it's about relationship. You understand when you have a set of rules that you can work with both sides, you say, you know, if I want to value you and make sure that both sides has a voice, it has a valued input, that everybody gets a chance to speak and we're working for the same goal, same thing anywhere. So I think that those skills are transferable.
Cyrus, are you endorsing Hillary Clinton?
I am. Yeah, I did.
You already did? Okay.
I did earlier this year. I actually used to work for Hillary Clinton.
How is she working?
Well, I didn't work closely with her. I was, when I was an undergraduate living in New York City, I began kind of my political path, so to speak, as an intern in her main Manhattan Senate office. It was her first year in the Senate. In fact, my first day of work was September 14th, 2001. So 15 years ago yesterday and 3 days after 9/11. So what I experienced that year working, then I went on and worked in her political office in 2002. What I learned though, working in her constituent services office was, you know, usually an internship like that means you're taking Social Security complaints or helping people with immigration issues. In our case, it was helping displaced businesses and individuals from Lower Manhattan relocate to Hoboken or Queens or Staten Island. And it really taught me that no matter how famous you are, no matter how high up you go in politics, your primary role is to help people and a city and a country even in crisis. And that's what we experienced as New Yorkers, and that's what her office very much set that tone, and I learned it there.
Yeah. Marty, are you endorsing Donald Trump?
Yeah, as Senator Habib said, yes, I have, and I am. So it took a long time to get there. We do a radio show as well, and we've been talking about politics since the beginning. And when 17 were in the race, we all had our favorites, but we all made the commitment, too, when they came through the primary. Whoever made it, it's our endorsed candidate, so we were quick to do so. And as you can see, things are coming around for him here as well as in the polls, so we'll have to see what happens. But yeah.
Speaking of your radio show, do you think that that's where you get your major support from? And by that I mean, have you become known enough to be in the position that you're in now, do you think, based primarily on your radio show?
I think it had a very small effect, and we can look at the numbers as well. I got my tail handed to me in King County, which is where our radio station is. but we won everywhere else in the state. So they don't hear my radio station over there.
Well,
so yeah.
Well, all Republicans get their hat handed.
Well, I understand that, but to answer your question though, you would see a greater impact in the area where we actually broadcast if that was true. It certainly didn't hurt me knowing the issues, talking about them, made me better about on top of things. But every day we talk about the issues that face Washingtonians.
But what's the most controversial thing you've said on your radio show?
Oh boy. Well,
just give me the top.
Our radio show is on a conservative political talk station,
yeah.
And we're tagged as Eyes on Washington, social and political commentary from a Christian perspective.
Right.
So we come at it from this is our worldview. You know, how are Christians supposed to respond to politics? How are we supposed to get engaged?
Well, have you ever gotten into any hot water saying something stupid?
I'm sure. No, I have not. My
You've never said anything stupid?
I'm sure I've said something stupid. I haven't gotten hot water yet. Now my co-host has actually gotten hot water a couple of times because he said something like, "You're going to get in trouble," and sure enough, he gets emails from people saying that wasn't very nice, you know, and it wasn't mean or anything. It was inappropriate. So. He likes to be a comedian, so.
Okay, but you're pretty straight-laced.
Hey, Abbott Costello, I'm the straight guy, you know, so.
All right.
Yeah.
No, I'm curious, and I don't want to get into this too much, but so your talk show is social and political commentary from a Christian perspective.
Mm-hmm.
How do Christians, what's the word I want? How do they justify supporting Trump?
Yeah, that's a good question. It's
among other anti-Christian.
Right, and obviously I can't speak for all Christians, but it's one of those things where the reason we named it that, too, is we looked at the numbers during the Romney campaign. When you had anywhere from numbers of 39 million to 57 million Christians in the U.S. didn't cast a vote. So you're like, why is that? You know, when you are a sizable portion of the United States, why are you not exercising your civic duty to vote and to get engaged? And so part of our thing is just get engaged, involved in your community, make a difference. And as far as why they support Trump, I think only because, and I've done some very unscientific random searches around the state, but I've talked to a lot of people, some of the most conservative, older Christians that you would think would be more aligned with Huckabee or a Cruz were Trump's day one. And I said, why? And they said, because he tells it like it is. And I go, and they value that more than...
Debatable.
Yeah, and I'm not saying it's right or wrong, but I'm saying this is what they tell me.
Yeah.
And then the other ones, you know, literally, it's when you talk about lesser of two evils and that kind of stuff, in this race you hear it out a lot. The other thing I hear all the time was, what we're doing is not working. You know, so that, you know, their justification for that tends to be that way. And it's not based on the Christian values. It's just, here. I'm like, okay. So I've asked the same question. But,
and I was just curious, and that's kind of a side note.
And for me,
we'll
it's, you know,
Lieutenant Governor now. But let's see, Brad Owen has been in this position for 20 years or so, and is retiring. How would you approach the job differently? And do you see Lieutenant Governor's job more as advocating and proposing and developing policy, or just being a gatekeeper for what the Senate is doing? Let's start with Marty.
And I think this is one of those areas where we come at it somewhat in similarity. Me and my opponent is, I think it's one, administratively, you have to be somewhat of a nonpartisan when you're working with both sides, knowing we have a job to do. Here's the tone we're going to set moving forward. The advocacy part comes in, what's best for the state, to being that champion? Because we know that every state legislator, every senator serves their district. And oftentimes, that's all they can do. The lieutenant governor has an opportunity to have a statewide view and to be an extra set of eyes and hands to help out in those districts. I've got specific plans outside of session to go into the local areas and talk about solution, finding solutions together at the local level with the local senators and House members as well. But in the Senate itself, I think you can suggest legislation or request it. And there's some things like that, just common sense ideas that gathered in from subject matter experts like businesses around, you could bring to the table. And I talk about this in our campaign, about every state agency has a budget, right? At the end of the year, if they don't spend their budget, they lose it. It's crazy. It sounds like government gone amok. And we can do this in 100 different ways. You know, why is this, right? So why don't we fix it? And, you know, whether Bill Bryant gets elected or Jay Inslee stays there, Mark Meloche is running for state auditor, we've talked about it with a bunch of people and senators, we can fix it. You're already budgeting for the budget. Let's just fix it. You can't lose it no matter what. However, for every dollar you save through innovation or cost savings, verified by the auditor the next year, we can reallocate that savings. 10% of it goes towards the employees that save the money as a bonus. Now you're incentivized to do the right thing. But then you can take 20% and reallocate that for pensions that aren't being paid. And you take the rest of it and reallocate it for education. Then everybody wins, right? Because we all want to do what's education. We're trying to find better ways. And it may be a small amount of money, maybe a large amount of money, but you're incentivizing government agencies to actually restrain themselves and do the right thing. It's like buying yogurt, right? When it has a little pink cap on it, you're more likely to buy it because you're doing something good, that type of thing.
Cyrus, what's your view on the role of the lieutenant governor?
Well, it's a complex job that does not lend itself to, you know, easy sound bites. It is, and that's because part of the powers of the lieutenant governor in the Constitution, some are in statute, some are in Senate rules, and then some are by convention, and some are by assignment. By the governors at the governor's discretion. Here's some ways I would use the office differently. One is, I think, you know, we are one of the handful of states where the governor and lieutenant governor run separately. In states where they run together, just as with president and vice president, there's kind of a negotiation, you know, before the campaign, right? And a kind of an understanding of here's what my portfolio will be. And sometimes it works better than other times, and there's all types of, you know, jokes made at the expense of number two elected officials. But I think, what I haven't seen Brad Owen do with the three governors that he's worked with is develop that type of a partnership. Because it's a big state. And so for the governor, you know, even when he is in the state, he can't be in more than one place. When you factor in the first lady, they're spread thin, given that, being down here and being in Spokane is quite difficult in the same day. So I'd like to be a partner with him to make him be more effective just in outreach in that sense as a partner. Secondly, I have a real fondness for, you know, working with officials in other states and in other parts of the world to advance our state's interests. So, for example, just a couple days ago, I co-hosted a fundraiser and spoke on behalf of my friend Tobias Reed, who's running to be the state treasurer in Oregon. I think that there's a number of ways in which Washington and Oregon are going to be working, continue to work together, and a statewide official like that. Take, for example, if there were some work on the CRC, not to bring up an unnecessarily contentious topic, but if there were, the state treasurer in Oregon is obviously going to be a part of the financing discussion around that piece, and we're going to need to work as partner states in that. So building those relationships. Gavin Newsom, the lieutenant governor of California, came up here to speak at my kickoff. So building those relationships, particularly in our region, but also overseas. And then finally, I do think it's important that lieutenant governor travel and do trade missions and friendship and global partnership missions, but I would not accept private dollars or private, you know, kind of for hire arrangements where a private company invites me to go there as lieutenant governor. Brad Owen points out that he doesn't use taxpayer dollars for his trips overseas, and I can see where there's virtue in saying that. But if it's truly work in the public interest, then make the case, you know, to budget writers, use that money to go and travel if there's going to be an ROI for the state. Otherwise, you shouldn't take money from private entities to go and do that work, because you end up in a lot of trouble.
So do you approve or disapprove of his trip to Cuba?
I don't know how the financing for that trip worked. I don't have a problem with it as a, because it's Cuba.
No, I'm not talking about it.
No, I don't know the...
It was not publicly funded.
Okay, well...
It is, I think, as... It's right. Obviously funds other than through the public.
Right. So so the way I would do it, it's a challenge, right? Because we're cash strapped, and Commerce has got some money to do this. And what I've suggested is that we do, no pun intended, a blind trust. So basically, private companies that want to fund this kind of work, and I think large and small businesses can benefit from it. In fact, I think small and medium-sized businesses benefit even more than large businesses that already have overseas operations. Can pay into a fund, but it would the donor would be concealed, so that there's no risk of bias in how the trip is planned, and the trip would need to be, the agenda would be need to set by staff and by partner organizations like Chambers of Commerce, the Trade Development Alliance, not by a host company or entity or host government.
Marty, what do you think about this lieutenant governor's trip to Cuba?
Don't know a lot about it. So I obviously commented on it. Going to Cuba, what was the point? What was the incentive? What did he get from it? Any trade with any country that represents Washington in a good way would be positive. But
well,
And then we'll get off of this topic. And I'll ask this question to both of you. Regardless of how these trips are paid for, do either of you believe that these trips are more business inclined or more, that sounds like a good trip to go to? We'll start with you, Marty.
Obviously, I can't speak for Brad, but in the public aisle,
any of them. This one. These trips that you guys take to all of these places.
And I would assume, the public, which I am one, a citizen, you wonder about that and greatly, that is it 60-40, 70-30? I know the intent is there, but hey, what a great trip. What can I do there to justify the trip? That's part of it. And I'm sure there's some that, hey, I want to go here while I'm there. What can I enjoy while I'm there as well? That's pretty common for business as well. If I'm going to do a convention in San Diego and make sure I take a couple extra days to do something else on my own dime. So
Mark, do you have a view on that sort of philosophical point about whether these, no matter what it is stated the trip is for, whether these have a little bit more to do with a good time than business?
Let me say this. You can do a good trade mission and you can do a bad one. For it to be successful, and have a good outcome, the trade mission really needs to be kind of the midpoint, not the starting point. So you need to spend a few months, actually beginning discussions and in conversations that are consummated with the face-to-face. You can't go there as a face-to-face and say, hey, I just wanted to introduce myself. No, you should be doing that. Staff and the elected official, when appropriate, should be doing that work and outreach, should be working with the Trade Development Alliance, for example, or chambers, other industry groups or civic organizations to be doing that in advance so that the trip is productive. Secondly, I think we don't recognize this in part because our politics have made people quite cynical in this country, but there is a huge value to the kind of dignitary presence of an elected official. Again, we're quite jaded about our politicians, but it means a lot in China that somebody who's the lieutenant governor or, vice governor, as they call them in provinces of China, has taken the time to come over there. They really value that, and they make a distinction between an elected official and a bureaucrat. And so I think we should just be aware that to the extent we are trying to consummate deals and strengthen ties, that there is dignitary value in someone being there. And then thirdly, a lot of the value, there can be kind of business deals, foreign direct investment, tourism and trade promotion, but there's also university partnerships. In my district, for example, I've been a part of working on this. Next week, we are launching the Global Innovation Exchange, a first of its type union between Tsinghua University, which is China's MIT, and UW, and Microsoft is giving some of the startup money. It's taking place in Bellevue. That took place because of a number of relationships and trips that were taken with universities. So it's not just business. For example, I would hope that in Brad Owen's trip to Cuba, he is looking at their healthcare system, which I think in a lot of ways is very innovative and front, kind of avant-garde in a lot of ways. Lots of countries around the world look to Cuban doctors for help with things like rural medicine, And so when you look at Clark County that has a significant healthcare sector, maybe that's an area where a Kaiser Permanente / group health could talk to doctors over there and see if there can be some kind of cross-training opportunity that's allowed now. But those are things that, again, you need to start that discussion before you go.
Cyrus, Brad Owen has said that he thinks he might be too partisan for this job. Would you agree with that, or is he off base on that?
He's off base, and I mean, we've had we've had a disagreement during this campaign, and it's unfortunate the way he, the way he dealt with it. But I never wanted to make this, because he's not running, so I never wanted to make this about him. Brad Owen, it's quite well known, has had some difficulty knowing the limits of the office. Has been reprimanded numerous times in his 20 years, and was recently fined $15,000 personally for not for exceeding the scope of his office. So there's an irony in him reproaching me for making suggestions or you know, presenting a different vision for the office. But I don't think there's any way you could say I'm too partisan. Look, Bill Finkbeiner, who was the Republican candidate for lieutenant governor in 2012 and was the Senate majority leader, Republican majority leader, the last time they controlled the majority, has endorsed me in this race. And I've got Republican supporters at the local level as well. You know, he maybe was miffed that I announced my campaign early on, and we had to do that because of the fundraising freeze. And so I think there were maybe some hurt feelings. Maybe we could have handled that better on the campaign side. But I don't think any of his statements actually stand up to scrutiny.
And Marty, you've, as a talk show host, you've been described as unabashedly conservative. Mm-hmm. Are you too partisan for this job?
No, it's the fact of being a conservative means you want everybody's input. You know, the idea of loving your neighbor truly is putting other people first. So I think, you know, those values, being a conservative, actually works in my favor for being lieutenant governor, working on both sides. And it means that, hey, you know, I see the value in every human being, man, woman, and child, and it's, and what they have to contribute. And this is not a dig on Cyrus. I just want to talk to him about this, too. But, you know, we have a quote from one of your questionnaires, Cyrus.
Huh?
It just says, you will champion progressive values in every corner of the state and will work with legislative Democrats to advance a progressive agenda.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so that to me seems like it's more partisan than not. It's not about Brad Elwin. It's just, you know, there is a difference in who, where we, the stance we come from. You know, being conservative, there's nothing wrong with that. In our state, we model all whether you're progressive or conservative, we come from a different angle, but we want the same thing. Every community, they want safer communities. They want more jobs. They want more liberty, those type of things. So I think, you know, in that regard, it doesn't hurt us, but it does tell you who we are and kind of our stance.
Well, then
you want to respond to that, or do
go ahead. Yeah.
Well, no, I mean, I you know, I will, and I think that the way that sentence, I appreciate you reading the full sentence, mm-hmm. because what it points out is when it says in every corner of the state, it's not talking about me as the presiding officer, right? It's very important that as presiding officer, that you be fair and be balanced. But as that sentence said, you know, when I'm traveling around the state and when I'm advocating for issues, just as my friend Bob Ferguson announced a couple days ago with respect to assault weapons, you know, of course the Attorney General is nonpartisan in the enforcement of our civil laws, right, and our consumer protection laws. He cannot have a partisan approach, and he doesn't. But, you know, is that a progressive value or a progressive issue? Of course we know assault weapons and all issues related to firearm safety have become highly, in my view, inappropriately politicized and partisan. But he's using the bully pulpit of the office to do that, and I have my values, and I would use the bully pulpit of the office in all four corners of the state to do that, and this will be one of those four corners.
Thank you. Marty, what do you think about the Attorney General's proposal?
I obviously, I'm a big Second Amendment supporter, endorsed by the NRA, Gun Rights Coalition, you name it. So that is one of those partisan things we come down to, but beyond that, if someone asked me, you know, do you support the Second Amendment? I go, yeah, but I think it's a God-given right to defend yourself that's enumerated in our Constitution. So it's very important to me. So the whole Bob Ferguson thing with coming out with the AR-15s and assault rifles, it's the terminology we use. You know, when you're coming from the left, you're talking about, you know, gun safety, you're talking about, you know, assault weapons. From the right, you're talking about, you know, firearm safety as well, but you're talking about, you know, our right to hold and bear arms, our right to go hunt and fish, whatever. But AR-15 is not an assault rifle. So it's, if we go back and forth, I understand the need to be safe, but removing or eliminating someone's rights that's enumerated just doesn't make sense to me, because it's a slippery slope. You remove one right from somebody, then what's next? Property rights, individual rights, your First Amendment rights, and so forth. So I was not a fan, obviously came out against it, so it's a place we disagree on. And the state as well. There's a big discussion going on about how to go forward. But on that note, but solutions, that's where we're going forward. How do you solve this? Do you solve it by banning having AR-15 style weapons? Or do you solve it by education, right? You know, it wasn't that long ago, even when I was growing up, where they had firearm safety in high schools, right? Can you imagine if people actually understood that they are a tool, that they're how to be safe with them, and how much lower that would bring the hysteria, was actually educating people on it. So,
now, along the lines of firearms, mm-hmm. what do you think should be the policy in the public gallery of the Senate?
Yeah, that's another place we disagree. I know that Brad Owens kept out open carry because of the visual aspect of it, and that's within his right. I wouldn't. I know that my opponents talked about also banning the concealed carry ones there as well. Once again, these are people, men, women, children, went through background checks to get these concealed carry permits. They're law-abiding citizens that are there doing their civic duty. I would not remove that from them. Once again, who am I to take away their constitutional right to carry anywhere, for that matter? Because then you start picking and choosing where you're going to say you can have it here, but not here. And I don't agree with that. So,
Cyrus, your thoughts?
Well, yeah. I mean, I came out with this statement after a number of these tragedies, including ones, taken place, against public officials. But certainly, places where there are large numbers of children. Look, it's all well and good to say that people who have a concealed weapons permit have been vetted. But as you know, Marty, they nobody's checking for those, right? There's actually no, I would even be open to that as an intermediate step or as a compromise. But it's not like anybody checks. So what happens as a practical matter is anyone can take a tote bag with any type of gun into the gallery, and nobody knows who that is. And look, my major issue is not for, even my safety or Lauren's safety as a member of the press who's there. It's really for the members of the public. We have high school pages who every week come down and work on the Senate floor. We have members of our staff. There are kids all around the gallery. That's the largest set of people that are ever in the legislative building during session are school kids coming on tours. This is a target-rich environment, and there are people with serious mental health challenges that are set off by issues, and it's not to the on the left or the right. It could be about abortion, or it could be about environmental protection, right? And we've seen that, and so just like is the case in county buildings and in city halls and in federal buildings all over this country, it is a very reasonable basic step to say that this is not a place where you need to have a gun, and we should have a way to check it, and you can pick it back up when you leave the gallery.
So then, go ahead.
No, go ahead.
How would you propose checking?
Right, so I've said I want to have I don't want to do it the way Brad did it. I want to actually engage Republicans and Democrats, representatives of the media, and staff, as well as those who work as government relations or lobbyists, folks that are there day to day, to say, how can we do this in a way that's not obstructive and an obstacle to people doing their jobs and to people's convenience? Let's figure out how to do it. So I'm not going to do it by decree, even though if there is a lack of action altogether, I will look at what steps can be taken to clear guns out of the gallery. But I'd rather we sit down and figure out what's the way to do it. As I said, I'd even be open to doing something that would verify the the vetted folks who have concealed weapons permits that Marty's talking about. That would still be better than the status quo. But I certainly think when it comes to open carry too, the issue there, I'm less concerned about a lone wolf killer than I am the issue of intimidation of senators and others. And I mean, think about it. You have a 7-year-old coming on a second grade school tour. Do they need to be sitting next to someone with an AR-15 or 5 of them or 10 of them who are trying to make a statement? That's just not a way to have a positive experience for a family. And we have lots of vulnerable people who come through. In addition to kids, we have groups who represent people with disabilities. We even have veterans with PTSD who are coming down to lobby. This is just not necessary to do this.
Marty, how would you respond to that?
A series of things there. First of all, there's a certain amount of decorum, obviously, that you could expect even the open carry people to understand that, okay, this may not be appropriate in this setting. Not that it's against their right, because they have the right to do it, but, it's none of us that's the education. But when it comes down to the kids and being safe and that kind of stuff, once again, if you had show your ID, I'm carrying, let people know you're good to go. And, there's common sense ways to deal with this without removing their right to carry. And as far as the danger, right, the people that are mentally unstable coming in, whether it be a metal detector or whatever, I'd rather have others that are armed in the gallery to put a stop to it if something like terrible like that happened versus having them unarmed. So once again, we see things a little differently there. And of course, we all want safety to be paramount. Absolutely. you know, but it's one of those things where we have to balance safety and people's constitutional rights and not step on one, basically. So
let's talk a little bit about Clark County and Vancouver. And we all know where we are logistically in this state, a long, long way away from King County and Seattle. We know the population base as well in King County and Seattle. But my question, and I'll go to Cyrus first, mm-hmm. proportionately, do you think us poor souls down here right next to Oregon, proportionally, are we getting our money's worth in terms of Olympia and the state looking out for us?
Well, you know, there's, so first of all, there's lots of analyses around revenue versus expenditures that show that King County is a, you know, net exporter of resources, you know, financially when it comes to the our sales tax base and where money is spent. I don't know about Clark County specifically in that. There's some, you know, kind of idiosyncrasies with Clark County, obviously, because of its proximity to a sales tax-free state. But, you know, what I'll say is, I mean, I do believe that Clark County really missed out, and our state missed out, and our ports missed out, and by extension, our workers missed out on not taking federal matching and state, Oregon state funds to build the CRC replacement. And I, you know, and I think that, if nothing else, it's a disagreement that I've had with Senator Benton and Senator Rivers. Both of all three of us are on the Transportation Committee last year, and so I think that that is a real disappointment, you know, in terms of resources here. What I one solution that I've put forward, and I think Lauren may have reported on this before, I think, is I've suggested allowing pre-recorded remote testimony, because I want to think about what can the, you know, I did this actually before I was a candidate for lieutenant governor, but I think it's relevant here because the president of the Senate's not going to be voting very often, but as a legislative leader can help us think about the structure of the legislative process. So I've said, look, it's really difficult for people from Battleground or Bellevue or Blaine to be able to come to Olympia for maybe 90 seconds of testimony at best. And so let's figure out ways in which people can get their voices heard, our voice, you know, as constituents. And what I've said is everybody, almost everybody, has a camera, video camera on their phone or their laptop. And in the era of YouTube and Snapchat, we ought to be able to, and I've suggested using TVW as the kind of the back door for this, the back office for this, submit remote testimony on issues that then legislators on those committees can listen to in their office, not in live committee. So it's ways like that that I'd like to get Clark County and other places that are a little farther from Olympia to have your voices heard.
Marty, are we getting our dime's worth out of you guys?
I completely don't think so. Now that said, you can do numerically and say the amount of people per dollar spent, and Cyrus is probably right in that regard as far as the number of dollars coming from the King County area. But it's one of the things I've seen around the state, whether it be in Vancouver, whether it be in Spokane, whether it be in Tri-Cities, is they don't feel like they have a voice, first of all, and the things that come out. Even this transportation budget was pushed by the Republican caucus on both sides, the largest in state history, right? And the number one project was supposed to be a 167, right? But yet it's like number 47 on the list, right? Where do the priorities go to? You know, it's not first. And it should have been first. So a lot of these projects should be tied to, if we're going to do the bridge across to Oregon, then make it a priority, and taxes raised here would go for it first. I understand that it's not as simplified as that, but I do think that many of the counties outside of King County get a little shafted in that regard. From all the tensions on Big Bertha, on the roads, on 405, which are important, but so are the rest of the state. And the issues are different, too. And I'll give you an example. In Grant County or in Okanagan County, the issues are much more about property rights. You know, about how to use your land and how they can and take it away and reintroduce the wolves. In King County, it's 4 or 5. They don't care about the wolves as much over there. And same thing down here in Vancouver. The issues are different. And that's why I talk about what I talk about is outside a session. One of the roles as a lieutenant governor is to engage community. And what I want to do is come down to Vancouver, get together the local government leaders, the local elected officials, the local business leaders, the local ministry leaders, the local nonprofits, and say, what are the 3 to 5 things that you want to address in Vancouver that isn't being addressed by Olympia? Is there a local solution for it? Is there a business solution for government? Is there something that the nonprofits or churches can deliver in a more efficient and timely way? Is there something that government's doing, a regulation or a rule or red tape, that's in the way that doesn't allow you to work together? I give an example out in Gig Harbor. There's a government agency doing homeless work, giving clothing and food, and a church group doing the same thing for the same group, and they can't work together because the rules don't allow it. So those type of things I can bring back to the Senate and say, next session, this is what Vancouver needs us to do to help them help themselves. I think that's another way of being an extra voice.
And Marty, would you have voted for the transportation package and the gas tax increase?
I wasn't there. I was against it, and I was disappointed when they voted for it. But now that they have, though, we have to be very. And I think it was good they didn't confirm Lynn Peterson, because you have to toe the line. So we need to hold accountable and actually address these based on what the people voted for.
And Cyrus, I'm assuming you did vote for.
I did, yeah.
Okay, thank you. And you both sort of touched on the CRC. We know what all too well what happened. Up in Olympia. Cyrus, let's start with you. I think you've already indicated that you were in favor of the project and disappointed that it didn't go through. Where are we, and what can we do to, I mean, we still need something.
Right.
So where do we go from here?
Well, I think a lot is going to depend on the outcome. Politically, a lot will depend on the outcome of the state Senate race in the 17th district, because that's really one of the three kind of loudest districts, right, on this issue in Olympia. And so I think having if it were the case that Senate, I haven't talked to Representative Probst, hopefully Senator Probst, about this topic, but I think we need to go to the Department of Transportation and to Oregon and try to reinitiate a conversation. The problem is that, as you all know, these transportation packages work because they are packages where everybody pays and everybody benefits, and it's really hard to do an isolated, a broad revenue source for an isolated project. We need to kind of do it as a collective compact, and so that was a real missed opportunity for Clark County, for our state, for the Port of Seattle. I mean, there's so many different ways in which, for safety, for economic viability of our West Coast ports, to compete with the broadened Panama Canal, to compete with Prince Rupert. We need to have better freight mobility and better mobility generally across the Columbia River.
And Marty, your view on a CRC, and where do we go from here? Or the failed CRC?
Right. Obviously, as my opponent said, we've talked about it, it's a priority. As Lieutenant Governor, it's leading the conversation and understanding that those that represent this district, championing with them, getting to know the issue. How can we get this in a timely, orderly fashion, knowing it's good for the whole state? Cyrus mentioned the ports. We have a prime example when the longshoremen had their strike recently. You had the hay prices that were $60 a bale, now down to $6 a bale because they went elsewhere, right? It was this lateral type thing where there's a cascading effect, affects the whole state when our ports are affected. So we need to improve our congestion relief. We need to improve our roads. Obviously, I heard Bill Bryan's plan the other day, and I'm a big champion of actually opening up these things, getting these projects done. And obviously, I'd be a champion for it.
You mentioned Bill Bryan, and earlier Cyrus talked about a lieutenant governor developing some synergy with the governor, whoever that is. What do you see in regards to that, what your role would be with Bill Bryan administration?
Absolutely, and that's one of the places that I would agree as well. I think there's been a lot of siloing going on for years, You know, the lieutenant governor does this, the governor does that, and so on. All the statewide offices. I think you can have greater synergy. And on the finance committee, you work with the treasurer and the governor looking at investments for the state. I think you could work with the commissioner of public lands as well, dealing with how we deal, orchestrate the DNR lands and all that management, emergency management. I think there's going to be some overlap. I think you can work with Secretary of State and the auditor. An auditor in a very specific way, making sure that these agencies and we're doing what we're supposed to be doing and bringing real value. So I do see that as a much bigger part of the job, and something I would do is really engage more with the other statewide office holders and say, how can we work together for the benefit of the state, so that a lot of these things aren't redundant, but we coordinate efforts so that we're more efficient as well.
And then how do you think you would work with an insulated
legislature? You know, yeah, once again, it's the way it's been for years, whether you have same office or not office. I'd work better with a Bill Bryant, but I would work great with Inslee as well. Coming from my point is my whole thing is to make sure that the people of this state can have better opportunities to work, have safer communities, you know, have an opportunity to invest their own talents in it, to grow the state by advertising, promoting what we have. We have great economic drivers. So working with Inslee would be fine as well. The idea is he has to have this overarching plan. I got to work with the Senate in trying to say, how do we make the ends meet, so to speak, so that the people of Washington actually are rewarded.
And so, Cyrus, how would you envision the opportunity with the Bryant administration?
Yeah, well, I mean, first of all, I have a very good relationship with Bill. He and I both attend St. James in Seattle. So I run into him at Mass, and we've always had a good relationship from when he was on the Port Commission. You know, there are a lot of areas where I think we could work together. His background on the port, I'm sure, means that trade and economic development is going to be highly important for him. And so I'd work with him on trying to promote our state and domestically and overseas. I have certain, you know, projects that I'm particularly interested in that I'd like to get, you know, the governor's buy-in, whoever the governor is, and the legislature's buy-in to work on. For example, there are so many different scholarship and financial aid opportunities available to high schoolers when they're looking at college, particularly at-risk kids. But those aren't any good if you don't have a guidance counselor who can let you know about what you're eligible for. So I'd like to create a statewide portal where you enter information, at, you know, demographic and financial information, and it curates a list of potential financial aid opportunities. And we could showcase and highlight and award and honor those guidance counselors who are helping. Similarly with disability employment, creating a public-private partnership to allow high schoolers. You know, we have IEPs for high school, for K-12 students, but as soon as they leave high school, if you have a disability, we've got nothing for you. What we should do is start giving young people with disabilities access to internship opportunities like everyone else. And there are private sector partners who are interested in giving those internship opportunities. So I think we could also, again, use technology to create that kind of portal. And I mentioned remote testimony as well. So these are just some areas that, you know, that are discrete and that we can do within existing resources. But it does require the governor and his staff and the legislature to recognize our ability to do that and to support the work of the lieutenant governor in doing that.
Just one more thing I'd like to add. Yeah, if Bill Bryant does get elected, and I do as well, and we're honored to do so, there's something we both are passionate about. We've been talking about it separately and together along the campaign trail. It was his idea of reinventing the last 2 years of high school. The idea that we have one in four high schoolers that don't graduate, most of them boys. And so one in four go to college, one in four go to community college. So what happens to the rest of them? So introducing pre-apprenticeship programs into the high school level, restoring skill centers, so when they graduate, they actually are 2 years further into an apprenticeship for a good-paying family wage job. My brother runs the West Coast version of the Millwrights. Very passionate. I got endorsed by him the other day. But you know, I've seen his story. You know, he was a high school dropout, but he got into the Millwright program, and he was the youngest business agent in four states in state history. You know, and he found something he's passionate about, and he's made more money than I'll probably ever make doing that, and never went to college. So there's options for people out there, so I'm passionate about that.
So how many, could you each tell me your understanding of how many employees actually work in the lieutenant governor's office? And whether you would seek to expand or contract that that number, and if the mission of the office overall is on track with how you would want to take it. Sorry, you want to start with that?
Yeah, there are five employees in the Lieutenant Governor's office. There have been one or two more in the past, and so the Lieutenant Governor's office, as with a number of other agencies, has seen cuts, both as a result of the recession, those cuts were not restored, but also obviously as we all tighten our belts to accommodate the McCleary ruling and our constitutional duty. And so I think it's, how I would structure the office is to definitely have one person whose primary responsibility is outreach. I see the Lieutenant Governor as an at-large member of the legislature, right? President of the Senate, but elected by everybody. So uniquely, not indebted to or beholden to one particular district. So what that means is that, as with other at-large, for example, an at-large member of a board of trustees, when you're at-large, you ought to look for those voices who are often not heard. People with disabilities, communities of color, tribes. And I think that's where outreach can be really, really helpful. It's also geographical outreach. So somebody who has experience statewide. I'd also like to retain the position that has existed there, which is the Economic Development International Relations staff person, because there is a committee that Lieutenant Governor chairs, which is a bipartisan bicameral committee on economic development and international relations. And that's the person that will be doing that advance work and follow up on the types of outbound trade missions, but also serve as a liaison to the consular association for inbound opportunities as well. So then there's other basic functions like scheduling and communications as well as the administrative Senate work that needs to be done.
It's a funny topic only because not being there, but the feedback I've gotten from those in the Republican caucus is, there's been a Democrat in office for 20 years, right? And they said he's doubled the staff size over the last 20 years. He's got a bigger office and grumbling, right? And it's funny. So I would really look at that. I wouldn't grow it, that's for sure. And we may even actually cut it just because we want to be responsible. As long as we can do the functions that are called for there. But really, as far as the outreach goes, making sure that I am staffed enough to go around to all the state to engage in these projects, to work with the other executives as well. But also to be able to justify what we're doing and the money we're spending for that office. The idea is, last thing I want, and then the other thing the Republican caucus has said too, is we don't need a lieutenant governor. We can do a pro tem, right? The chair, like the House does. And so I think that there's one of the things that the previous administrations haven't done enough is to say, we are valuable. We're here to bring you together. We're here to set the tone. We're here to be an advocate for the state. So I would do that, make sure that they go, okay, it makes sense to have an office of lieutenant governor. So.
In sort of the tradition of the good old day debates, Cyrus, is there a question you'd like to ask Marty that you're dying to hear him answer?
Marty and I have had a chance to get to know one another. I feel like the kind of the point of that question in this context is to do a gotcha and get him on record on something. I don't
want
to do that. I guess what I would say or ask Marty is, do you feel like you're familiar with, So most of the lieutenant governor's rulings, parliamentary and constitutional rulings, have to do with scope and object, and have to do with single subject, and whether a bill is NTIB. Do you feel like you have a familiarity with those so that you'd be able to use your discretion to make those decisions? And if not, how would you prepare for that?
On the surface, yes. Obviously, I want to come in with the understanding that this really is about following the rules, about leading both sides, overarching agenda of saying what is right and fair and constitutional. I'm a big proponent of learning and leaning on those that actually know what's going on first. So I would lean heavily on both sides, the representatives from both the House, Democrat and Republican, to get me up to speed. And the staff has been doing it for over 20 years there. But that said, I'm very serious in leading groups, leading clubs as well. You're using Robert's Rules of Order. You understand how important it is. So I don't see an issue with that. I tell you, once I'm sworn in, I will be ready to go, guaranteed. Mm-hmm. But I appreciate the question, because it is. Yeah.
Marty, question you've been dying to ask Cyrus?
Boy, there are a lot of them.
Not the one.
In many ways, we come from opposite standpoints. And once again, I have talked about typically in every community, whether you're Democrat or Republican, conservative or progressive, you kind of want the same things about 70-80% of the time, just how you get there. I guess the question, it's not a gotcha question, but I wouldn't want to do that either. It's part of my whole campaign, it's a golden rule about being civil, right? And we've been very civil so far, but we want to declare and kind of talk about so that our voters can see there's a difference between the two of us. I'll ask this, and I'll stay away from some of the other ones that are more of a gotcha thing. Since you come from Bellevue, you're a Bellevue attorney, how are you going to represent those in Eastern Washington or Vancouver, I guess, in a way that's different than I would?
Well, I think, I presume that you supported Rob McKenna, a Bellevue attorney, for governor 4 years ago. So I don't think Democrats have a monopoly on that particular constituency group. But, what I've learned as an attorney in private practice, my office is actually in Seattle, I was an attorney for startups, helping entrepreneurs form a new business, choose whether to form as an LLC or a corporation, what the tax implications are, helping them to get access to financing, venture financing, debt financing, and then ultimately helping them think about an exit strategy, if that's appropriate for them. What that really attuned me to was the needs of entrepreneurs, which is a subset of small businesses. It's why I introduced first of its type crowdfunding legislation that then my friend Tobias introduced in the Oregon State Legislature, and other states have now followed, to allow small businesses to raise money in a crowdsourced way. So, I'm proud of that experience, having worked with startups. I think Clark County's got a really, really exciting opportunity that we've been seeing over the past few years to diversify economically and enter, and we've seen startups in the aerospace and drone arena. We've seen startups in healthcare, health sciences. And so that experience and being attuned to that and looking for ways that the international aspect of the position can be helpful to entrepreneurs, like what we're doing with UW and Tsinghua, creating a global innovation exchange. These things, I think, are hugely helpful in every part of the state. We've seen Lisa Brown taking advantage of WSU Med, the new med school in Spokane, to create a cluster around the life sciences in Spokane. It's hugely helpful there. Walla Walla in Southeast Washington with hospitality and wineries. And so every part of the state's got something to benefit from that.
Thank you. We'll move on. Give us your final pitch. Tell us why voters should support you. And please mention any notable endorsements you wish to. Marty?
Okay. How much time do I have?
Two minutes.
Okay. Thank you for having us here today. I really appreciate it, getting to know you a little bit and sharing kind of why we're running. I really do feel like there's government's lost the trust of the people. They feel like they don't have a voice. They feel like there's a lot of bickering and partisanship in government. They feel like nothing gets done. So I really want to be a solutions-based lieutenant governor. And the idea is bringing both sides together, being a bridge builder. Everything I've done in my life has been that way. My unique perspective of being the grandson of a farmer and rancher on both sides, my dad and my mom's family. I know about land rights. I understand how, the mom and pop or the average citizen lives, and many of them are paycheck to paycheck, or a bone paycheck away from being out there on the street. So I know that there's those issues in every community. I've been fortunate enough and unfortunate enough to live just about everywhere around the Puget Sound, Eastern Washington, but experiencing people. And when we're on the campaign trail, the people around the state are phenomenal. They have great talent, great skill. They're passionate about this nation and the state. And I want to bring that together and say, let's find a way to invest in your community and make it better. I really do believe in the golden rule, that if we can restore that, knowing that our neighbors have three basic needs, our senators have the three basic needs too, to be heard, valued, and respected. You start there, you change the environment of government where you're putting people first again, And it takes a long time, but it starts with one person. That's what I'll do, is starting teaching in that environment where I'm putting everybody else first. Ideas, so we have the big picture of putting, making sure the state gets blessed. You know, we can open up businesses. I know I'm agreeing with one more time there as well. Part of this is getting our economic engine going. Part of that is working with a Bill Bryant governor, if he is, or Jay Inslee, as he's there, to address these over-regulated, burdensome regulations right now that are just out of control. I know he's proposed a four-year moratorium on them to make sure that they are justified. I support that. So we'd work vigorously on that to get things going. So people know a stable regulatory environment so they can actually invest here in Washington. So, but once again, I'm passionate. I've got a perspective and principles, so we understand that we put first things first, and we'll make it out of here. So, thank you.
Thank you. And I'm sorry, any endorsements?
Yeah. Oh, we've got a list of endorsements on our website as well. But Ralph Monroe, Sam Reed, we've got obviously Bill Bryant, you know, the local candidates as well. We've got Liz Pike down here, as you guys know. Brandon Vick down here. We've got more coming that are not announced. NRA, of course, the Gun Rights Coalition. And we have more to come. And by all the counties, of course. Republicans.
Thank you.
Yeah.
And Cyrus, give us your final pitch to voters.
Well, again, it's not an easy job to encapsulate. But what I would ask is that voters think about, you know, who do you want making key constitutional and parliamentary decisions that can set a precedent? I not only have experience in legislature, but I teach legislative procedure at Seattle University Law School and have taught there for over 3 years. I am that rare species of legislative nerd who enjoys parliamentary procedure and constitutional law. I would also ask voters, you know, who do you trust to be the 25th vote? As I said, the race in the 17th, there's also a race up in my neck of the woods in the 41st, will determine the outcome of the state Senate. But it is highly possible that there'll be a slim one-vote majority, which means that if ever a senator is missing from the floor and there's a vote that's taken, the lieutenant governor would be in a position to cast a tie-breaking vote. So I think it's important that that person be someone who shares our values, particularly on social issues. We saw a 25-24 vote, for example, on the transgender bathroom issue just this last year, where had one senator not been able to scurry back in time, the lieutenant governor would have been the tie-breaking vote. And so it's important that person share values. I think voters should think about who they would feel comfortable leading and working with executive branch officials and agency and department heads when the governor's out of town, which can be as much as 60 to 70 days out of the year, particularly in a governor's second term when they take on leadership roles in national organizations. I think voters should think about who has a background of economic development, and particularly using the instruments of state to advance our economic development and global partnership priorities. And then finally, you know, I remember when I saw Donald Trump campaigning in South Carolina on TV, and his top surrogate was the lieutenant governor of South Carolina. And I remember thinking to myself, same with Gavin Newsom in California, that the color of title that comes with this office and the credibility that you get having been elected statewide does give you a role in even national and sometimes even international affairs of state. And so it's really important that we recognize the potential to make Washingtonians feel included and part of this system, or to make them feel like they are outside or excluded or felt made to feel separate. I'm somebody who, as I mentioned, having grown up with a disability, having grown up with Middle Eastern parents, I know what it's like to feel excluded, and I know that what makes this country great is when we come together and build bridges, not walls. And so I will be that person and use the office to set that tone in state government. So would appreciate the votes of your viewers and your readers, and would love the endorsement of this editorial board.
Right, thank you, and I'm sorry, endorsements?
Oh, as I mentioned Bill Finkbeiner, but notably Patty Murray and Maria Cantwell, Jay Inslee and Bob Ferguson, locally Doug Lasher and Annette Cleveland, my friend Monica Stonier, and just for old time's sake, Joe King, but many others in the state Senate, state House, and mayors, over a dozen, probably over 20 different mayors from all over the state.
Great. Well, gentlemen, thank you to you both.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.